much.
Thank you.
14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 100.
Showing the same thing you're seeing in this New York Times poll, and that is the numbers that Trump had when Biden was in the race are beginning to come back to Trump at about the same levels as before Harris became the nominee or the designated nominee. So you're seeing a complete return to where Trump was before. Whatever bounce was there is disappearing. And now I don't know what kind of nonsense we'll hear tomorrow night out of the media, because regardless of how well those Trump does, they're going to pretend like that she won this, and maybe they'll get a bounce out of that. But right now, Donald Trump has come on the upswing, she's on the downswing, and Nate Silver is right. It would carry those battleground states right now, and as they're correlated to where they were back in the Biden 2020 race against Trump.
Now that is exactly what we have been arguing now for weeks. The Democrats focus on switching out Biden. So
policy was bound to boomerang. It was bound to knock the Democrats back to the same polling they had with Biden. And that is exactly what we're seeing with Kamala. And no amount of glitz and glam and pop polling was going to be able to change that. Moreover, and I owe this observation to, particularly to Robert Barnes, they thought that by putting Kamala in as Biden's replacement, they thought they could reawaken the centrality of identity politics in this campaign. So Democrat operatives believed that because Kamala ticked all the right boxes, as it were, those boxes would correspond to voting constituencies reanimated by identity concerns. However, that's not what we're finding. When we look at the polling, particularly among the non-white working class, they are increasingly rejecting identity politics for class politics. So in other words, they're no longer seeing themselves in racial terms or gender, ethnic, or sexual terms. They're instead seeing themselves in economic terms. And they see Kamala as part of a permanent political class that governs according to its own interests and concerns, that's only concerned with their own power and affluence at the expense of the standards of living for the rest of us. This is what that CNN commentator that was flipping out at the beginning doesn't understand. She honestly thinks this election is going to fall back on identity politics. I, as a woman, am going to vote this way according to women's interests. And it's not. It's not. It's actually going back to class politics, where the people versus the permanent political class is becoming the dominating political paradigm animating this campaign. So it appears to be one of the reasons why Kamala's campaign just simply isn't working. The policies, particularly the economic policies, the Biden administration remain deeply unpopular among the vast majority of the country. No amount of rebranding appears to be able to overcome that unpopularity. So that's why the election forecasts are all moving to Trump. That's why the Democrats, like that CNN commentator, are in an absolute panic.
And I'm a result hunter, the search engine for conservatives. Let me just tell you what it does. First of all, big tech right now is run by a bunch of elitist people who all happen to vote the same way and who all happen to live in huge cities on the West Coast. And so Result Hunter takes those elitist values and elitist sources and kind of pushes them down a little bit in the search engine. Meanwhile, it takes those sources of truth that we believe have been deranked a little bit by Google, and it pushes those up a bit. And the main thing that you'll gain from using the search engine is that your ad revenue that you generate by going all over the web is much more likely to support conservatives and things that support conservative values rather than things that support. Like I said, the most heated debate I've seen yet on the Young Turks between Anna Kasparian and Jim.
get into these couple clips here from his episode of The Young Turks. Of Jake Duggar absolutely having a meltdown after Anna Kasparian destroys him for his ridiculous stuff. Let's check this out.
Harassment, yes or no?
Anti-Semitic rhetoric.
Change shop. I've got a smoky right in the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
criticism of Israel ever. Fire!
I mean, I'm worried about an inadequate citation from 1987, so I'm really concerned about her academic situation. Guys, when they find something this minor, that means, oh my God, she was squeaky. Oh, she had an immaculate life. I challenge any of you to go through this kind of process and have them come up with only exactly how he described. They find one little thing where Donald Trump's multiple things. You could say it's a little bit bigger, the things they found, than enacted citations. Their, you know, convicted felon stuff is bigger than that. But they find those little things and they just repeat it over and over and over again to try and hammer it into your head to make you change your opinion in person with Donald Trump. They did it with the convicted felon stuff recently. They say convicted felon, over and over again. Before, they did the Russian stuff. It's so obvious, and Jack didn't pick up on it, but it's the way he supports, but on the other side, he just buys into it. He just buys into it, and he buys into the very obvious pushing of, you know, propaganda. Let's see what Anna Kasparian has to say in response. Here in a second, it gets pretty awkward, too.
Jack, the reason why I'm frustrated with you is because you're itching to engage in your rant so desperately that you don't even give me an opportunity to lay out all the facts before you engage in your rant, in which you undermine and minimize the evidence that I'm going to show that shows that it's more than just a lack of citations four separate times.
Yeah, I'm not going to engage in your hatchet jobs.
Okay, listen.
No, that has no validity.
Okay, all right, fine, that has no validity. If your take is, I don't care if she engaged in any plagiarism, this is politically motivated, then just say it. But my point is, even though I believe it is politically motivated that they're going after her, if there are substantial examples of her engaging in plagiarism at a university where students get expelled when they engage in plagiarism, it's a problem.
But they already did the analysis, Anna. So now we're going to do a double analysis on some jackass stalker who's obviously doing it for political reasons. And guess what? By the time that they reevaluate their second set of nonsense charges, she'll already be fired. And Black will go, yes! I would again! Sending the full BS of reporters to find the real problems.
They did an analysis of the first round of plagiarism allegations that came out in October.
And
what a new round of allegations!
You all new round! What a surprising twist, a new round of allegations. Let's see if we can find more inadequate citations. I don't care.
Okay, then you don't care.
I don't care. Stand the fact that Anna Kasparian is being reasonable. He just wants a partner who is just going to melt down with him and say how bad the right wing is, how good the left wing is, and only acknowledge certain very obvious truths whenever it aligns with his ideology and aligns with his agenda, such as the things we're talking about in this video, where you can see the hatchet job very clearly whenever it's somebody on his side that's getting attacked, but whenever it's Donald Trump or anyone on the right, this happens over and over and over again. Like, you see it all the time, literally all the time. You can't pick up on it then. That's very obvious, you know, they're just telling the truth about the person. But when Anna Kasparian can pick up on that and can see very clearly, hey dude, it seems like you don't care about the facts whenever it's somebody on your side, but you care very much about these so-called facts whenever it's somebody on the other side. Like, he's literally, like, Anna Kasparian is literally saying, just that I don't care about the facts. Jake Huger just says, I don't care. I just don't. He just admitted straight up there. And this is why Anna Kasparian is kind of leaving the Young Turks. In 1997, went to somebody's house, broke the door down, stole their radio, I still wouldn't care. Because you're
trying to eliminate her because she said something you don't like. Don't go back into the past, find the tiniest little transgressions, and then we're going to have a debate over this poor woman's life and over her career. No, I'm not going to engage with bad faith actors who have shown 1,000 times over that they're full of crap and they're looking to destroy people's lives. So no, let me be very clear. I have no interest in a debate about plagiarism from 20, 30 years ago. So-called. When the first round of plagiarism came up with no plagiarism. None. They were...
Chang, shut up. Such an idiot.
Number 7 in response to any dating topics takes you want to speak on. If so, what? That men should pay for everything and be a provider for women they are dating. I think this idea pushes women into being unproductive, entitled, and lazy. Then you follow by saying men should provide for their wives with children who are stay-at-home mothers. Sure, but women situation.
Yes. What about it?
So I'm a little confused here. These are a little contradictory.
So if you have children with a man, if you want to be a stay-at-home mother, I think, yes, that a man should provide for you and give you that lifestyle if he impregnates you and wants that from you, or if you want that for yourself. But I feel like if in this culture it's like, oh, we need a date who are providers, and that pushes women into not being educated and not trying to get money for themselves, just which is not good.
I understand that it's not good.
I completely disagree with that. Younger, but also like be choosy with who you're picking. You shouldn't just pick any guy that has cash or someone that doesn't have any value. So you should pick someone, and I'm also a Christian woman, someone that loves God first more than anything, but like wants to lay down his life for his like wife that he's looking for. And so like I think this like hookup culture and like sitting around testing waters like is actually really powerful for women. So you should look for someone that's willing to commit as a provider and protector first. Plus, you can't marry in La La Land that you're never going to divorce. You have to have money. Just
votes.
And men also should. And essentially, the only option then would be a prenup, right?
No. No prenup. Never.
Why?
What do you mean? I'm going to literally give you my money. Why are you arguing like you are my money?
Oh, thank you so much.
No, why?
You gave someone your vagina. Wow.
Because why are you arguing that?
Gold. It was spun by Rumpelstiltskin himself. It was made out of gold. The thing is like, so what? He's giving you his penis too. Like, what is the thing that do you agree with a prenup? Yeah, I think that especially from a secular perspective, I can't think of a single reason why a secular man shouldn't get married. I couldn't give you a single secular argument for why a secular man should even get married. It makes zero sense. You can get all
it's
the benefits.
Hang on, let me explain
the argument and then talk through it. Okay. It makes no sense for a secularist to get married. I've never been able to figure out a really good argument for why. As it turns out, you can get all of the shit that you want from a woman without ever being married to her and putting yourself in that type of situation where you can be set up for a massive amount of pain because the courts are biased towards men when it comes to divorce. So from a secular perspective, I can't even offer a single argument for why secularists should get married. I can't offer one.
I completely agree with you. I think that if you get married, it's because you're religious. That's it.
Yeah, but the thing is that if you enter into a religious marriage with a woman, unfortunately, the state still comes in. So I would say get a covenant marriage, and I would leave the state out of it altogether. I think that having the state involved with marriage licensing is fucking stupid. And if you're getting married for religious purposes, then why aren't you getting married through the church? Why are you wasting your time with the state at all? Entering into the state contract still gives her incentives to eliminate the marriage. And if it gives incentives to eliminate the marriage, you have a big problem on your hands.
Well, what I'm confused about is that she's arguing that men should have the right to get a prenup, but she's also arguing that men should take care of women after
the marriage. Yeah, because she's trying to be consistent with her position, which I have respect for.
She's consistent.
So she's saying, if women are preparing to have a contingency, then it's okay for men to as well. That's consistent. That's at least a consistent position.
I'm so happy that you gave her that out and answered for her. Thank you.
Well, I didn't answer for her. I explained the position.
That's not yours. I was asking her.
It doesn't need to be mine to explain the position. Like, you understand? You know, I can understand what a person says and not be speaking. So I'm not giving an answer from her worldview. I'm just telling you what the worldview is. She's consistently saying if there's an out for one, it's consistent if there's an out for another. Okay, I don't even know. Like, what is the actual argument you have against that? It doesn't nullify it. So what is the actual argument?
She says that if a man and a woman get divorced, then the woman should have something to fall back on. Take advantage of and just take things from, then that's wrong. I didn't say I wanted
right? What's your position on that?
I said I think that it's totally okay for a man to provide for a woman in the dating stage. But yeah, I'm not gonna quit. I'm not gonna quit working.
Yeah, we're paying on. We're talking about prenups. So, do you think that prenup is acceptable for men?
Yes, but it works both ways. If the woman's dumb enough to not know that she can always stay in the prenup, that's on her. I personally know.
All right. So, what is your actual objection if she says that the woman can fall back on her education, the man can fall back on the prenup? What is the actual objection then?
So there wasn't any objection.
There wasn't any objection. So what the fuck are you arguing about?
I was questioning her because she was countering her own argument. So I wanted her to explain it further. But you explained it
for her. Own argument. How was countering her own argument? You didn't even understand her argument.
And thank you for elaborating for her. Now I understand.
Well, somebody needed to elaborate. You didn't. I mean, it's such a simple kind. I don't know why you didn't understand it. It's very simple.
Yeah,
you say one falls back on this, the other falls back on that. I don't even agree with that, but I mean, at least I understood what the hell she said, right?
Yeah.
Not sure what I missed, but let me quickly address this here, because I'm getting not only gaslit by a panelist, but also gaslit by the chat. This is exactly what Tamara said. She said, no, that's not true. You would date me the last time you told me. So, last time you told me, you would date me. I never said that. That's a false accusation. We've had other women come on the show who say that I'm in their DMs or say that I'm subscribed to their OnlyFans to try to get a clip or to try to, you know, kind of break down what I'm trying to do here. So you tried to gaslight me and say, no, that's not what I said. This is what you said, okay? And for the chat who's also gaslighting me, this is what this is what she said, and it's worthy of a defense.
And I will absolutely apologize for that.
All right. Okay. Have you ever heard the song I'm Sorry? Have you ever heard that song?
Is that Justin Bieber?
No, it's not Justin Bieber. No, it's an oldie song. It's called I'm Sorry. Have you ever heard that?
We're
all in
our
20s,
no.
Sorry. You never heard it?
No.
I feel like you should sing the I'm Sorry song. You guys are dressed up like Jessica Rabbit, she was a singer. You can sing the I'm Sorry song.
Thank you for the $100 super chat, man. Appreciate it. And then we have Pelagic. Prenuptial is nothing to get comfortable with and never look at it as a fallback.
I 100% agree with that, because anything could be dealt upon in litigation. Prenup, you have a good enough lawyer.
That's true. Andrew, can you tune me into what you guys were talking about while I was gone?
Yeah, so we were getting into the idea of contingency plans for marriage, the idea being women fall back on education. The one panel was saying, I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name. What did you say?
Jamie.
Yeah, it was what Jamie was saying was she thinks that men should be able to fall back. Women should be able to fall back on education.
Boring's out.
Thank you.
are you looking for a smaller church service? Have you been searching for a meaningful community?
Harris is not going to beat Trump in North Carolina. Not going to happen.
Hey.
the shop for a month waiting for this. And today is the day. We're so very excited about it. Ladies and gentlemen, today
Excuse me.
It's exciting. We've prepared for this moment. Kamala Harris has not. Kamala Harris apparently is in total and complete collapse. Even Democrats are trying to predict and something a Kamala collapse. We're going to talk all about it this morning. Melania Trump breaks her silence on her husband's assassination from the court.
Do that work.